Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the blessing of every ever virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. All those far off, whomever the Lord our God will call.
He testified with many other arguments and was exhorting them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 persons were added that day. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Responsorial, the Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Beside restful waters he leads me. He refreshes my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you are patient when you suffer for doing what is good, this is a grace before God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was insulted, he returned no insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten. Instead, he handed himself over to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body upon the cross, so that free from sin, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. For you had gone astray like sheep, but you have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
God.
Because they recognize his voice. But they will not follow a stranger. They will run away from him because they do not recognize the voice of strangers. Although Jesus used this figure of speech, the Pharisees did not realize what he was trying to tell them. So Jesus said again, Amen, amen, I say to you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. A thief comes only to steal and slaughter and destroy. I came so that they may have life and have it more abundantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today in John's Gospel, there's a beautiful story, a parable, a teaching, whichever word you use, from Jesus concerning the sheep and the shepherd. What I would like to do is I would show you a very neat thing that I've come to realize concerning the way we pray. Because as you know, the way we pray expresses our belief. If I'm not mistaken, off the top of my head, there's a Latin statement. I think it's lex orande, lex credende. I could be wrong. Okay. Or is lex credendi? No, it's lex orandi, lex credendi. I'm pretty sure. Okay, never mind. But what we want to do is show you how what we pray, the way we pray, expresses our belief. Because it's beautiful when you think of the liturgy. The liturgy, what is it? It's a cosmic reality. Our divine liturgy, where all of the cosmos comes together, the created universe, to give praise to God, its creator. Now, I remember, probably in the 90s, there was a movement in some Christian denominations where they would try to express this in the way that they prayed. And some would pray in tongues. It sounds almost like a baby language. And then out of that, some actually started making animal noises. And I don't make any of this up. And they said that the sounds that were coming out were expressive of how all creation comes to praise God. Now, this is not the movie Deliverance, so there's no one that should be squealing like a pig here. Okay? Do not, please, I ask you, I bet, never make animal noises. Okay? Instead, let us look at this through our liturgy, because this is beautiful. The way we as Catholics express it. Think of it this way. The altar rail. The altar rail serves as the border for the sheep who are in the corral. If you remember, this rail had a gate, and we still have that gate. Just needs to be restored, but we still have it. And that gate symbolically represents Jesus Christ. Now, in our Eastern churches, whether it be Eastern Catholicism or Eastern Orthodox, many of them do not have a rail. Instead, they have a iconostasis, if I said that correctly. It is a wall of icons. And if you know what an icon is, some people say it's a painting. More than that, it's a prayer that is expressed through painting in art.
and they would have a wall of icons. But all of them would have a moment in the liturgy where the gate is open, the icons are parted, to where you could see where you are being led. If you remember your childhood, your young days, when the Mass was in Latin, the priest in the procession would come first before Mass and open the gate, and then during the Mass he would come up, and the first thing he would do is say the prayers at the foot of the altar. And then once he prayed, he would ascend the steps and come into the sanctuary to offer the liturgy. If we go back to what Jesus is saying, he speaks of sheep, corral, shepherds. The shepherd leads the sheep. Where does he lead them? Psalm 23 tells us, verdant pastures. Okay, here you go. This part of the church, the nave, let that in your mind be the corral. You are the sheep. Now, please don't be insulted by that. Think of it this way. The sheep. And like sheep in any corral, we may not see them so often. This would have been more of an occurrence in Jesus' days, because they would have had a community corral. You would have had various shepherds with various flocks in the one corral. You think about our Catholic churches. Throughout the world, there are many flocks of sheep, but they all belong to the universal Catholic corral. Whether it be here, St. Bridget's, St. Thomas, Rome, Venezuela, Indonesia, it doesn't matter. Where the individual church is located, the corral is the same. Are we okay? And of these corrals, like in any corral, you're going to have various sheep. You're going to have white sheep, you're going to have black sheep, male sheep, female sheep, young sheep, old sheep. Look at the corral. There you go. Now, is the corral a place of freedom? No. Why? Because you always have to have the gate. The border, it protects the sheep in the corral. That's the beauty of the church, is that she always tries to protect her sheep. Because most people think backwards. They would say, well, hold on. What are you talking about? We're the community. You're in your area there. This is freedom. This is limited. And you have people expressing, oh, well, look at the priesthood. It's very limited. You know, they can't marry. They can't do this. They can't do that. Backward thinking. Let me give an example of a backwards thought. When Jesus asked his apostles, who do people say that I am? They responded, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, still others one of the prophets. And he says, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter gives the answer. You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Remember his statement, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. Mere flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my heavenly Father. And he gives him the name Peter, gives him the keys, but he says something. Upon this rock I will build my church, and
and the gates of the netherworld shall not prevail against you. Backward thought. Because most people think, when we speak of the gates of the netherworld, the gates of hell, not prevailing against the Church of Christ, they imagine that the church is behind the wall, behind the gates. The devil and his minions are on the outside, and they're laying waste to the wall. And the church is hoping, oh Lord, I hope the wall stands. That's completely opposite. Because if your front door is your gate, who's behind it? You or the burglar trying to get in? You. Okay? So when Christ says the gates of hell, so who's behind the gate? Satan. It says the gate shall not prevail against, meaning the church, Christianity, is always the aggressor. We're always on the attack. What are we doing? Destroying hell. Christianity has to be the one knocking down the gates. So don't ever think that we're supposed to be on the receiving end. Not so fast. We're on the giving end. We are called to correct the world's errors, to bring Christ to others, to always be moving forward in that aspect. Now, the corral. Is it freedom? No. Is the world freedom? Are you truly free? Have you ever asked yourself? We live in the United States of America, one of the freest countries in the world. But are you free? No. No. You'd be kidding yourself to believe that. Because nowadays, can you go out there and say what you really think? Probably not. Because someone will be offended. If you want to go fish snapper for your family in the Gulf, can you do it? Only for 3 days. 3 days. So think about it. Are you truly free? I encourage you, if you're so free, don't pay taxes. Yeah. This is limiting. Because you're always told what you can or cannot do. Someone's always labeling. Someone's always looking at you and they're making a preemptive judgment. You think about it. We're from Alabama and South Louisiana. There are some people who honestly think that all we do is have corn cob pipes, you know, and sit on the back with our chalk and our spittoon. Okay, with that backwards. That's an image. So this is limited. The shepherd comes and calls the sheep. Who is the shepherd? Priests and bishops. For this analogy. Now, unless you're a bishop and you've got your crozier, i.e. your crook and your staff, if you're just a regular guy like me, the priest, what is our means of protecting you from everything that wants to destroy your spiritual life? Sacred scripture, tradition. Guided by both of these, we are the new shepherds. And what is the shepherd called to do? Lay down his life for his sheep. What does the priest do? He lays down his life. Not physically, pray God, I hope. But what people call limits, the priest can't get married, they can't have this, they can't have that, that's laying down one's life. So that one can be completely at the disposal of the sheep.
And the shepherd comes and calls his sheep by name. How do we do that? By the beginning of the Mass, the universal call of Catholics, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And Catholics respond to that. That is God speaking through the priest to you, say, I call you by name. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. And then the priest leads the flock through the gate of Jesus. Where does he lead them? To the pasture. What is the pasture? Here. The sanctuary is a modern representation of what heaven is like. Because in heaven, there is freedom. Not to do anything foolish or bad, but there's freedom in love to be the person God has called you to be. Here we place limitations, structures, labels. In heaven, is there Catholic heaven as opposed to Baptist heaven, as opposed to Jewish heaven? No, there is heaven. Is there old people heaven and young people heaven? Heaven. White heaven, black heaven? Heaven. And in heaven, in the pasture, when the commands and the instructions of God are given, you look at how they're given. They're applicable to all. Love God. Love neighbor. Doesn't classify by saying your neighbor has to be this, that, and the other. It's just love neighbor. Don't cheat. Don't lie. Don't steal. These apply to every person, not just to a chosen few. So the shepherd, the priest, the bishop, they're called to speak the voice of God, to bring people to the gate. The gate is Jesus. And if we follow and do what Jesus instructs, what happens? We reach the pasture, paradise. But on earth, we reach it here in the sanctuary. And what happens when sheep reach the pasture? They are fed. They are watered. They are sustained. And what do we receive? Jesus Christ upon our altars. True food and true drink. The body of Christ, the blood of Christ. And we have that opportunity every day to receive the Eucharist. The last thing, because Jesus warns sheep and shepherds, beware those who try to come in through other means. They're thieves, they're robbers. You notice he doesn't specifically refer to any individual or any groups of people, because that statement can apply to so much more than a particular person. Think of it this way. Any person or persons or any ideas or concepts that promises you fulfillment and happiness by any other means is something you should be very wary of. It's like an idea like communism, which says if we all had a communal life, then everything will be peachy keen. We know that it doesn't work that way. It could be a person who comes and says, you want to be happy? Let me show you Jesus. But Jesus without the cross. And how many times have you heard ministers say, if you just send me $5, I will send you my, let me see if I got one. I'll send you a handkerchief. Alright? And here you go. It's blessed handkerchief. And if you hold this handkerchief and pray for $5, you'll get wealthy. Trust me, I have seen that stuff being peddled. It's garbage. That is not Christian. The shepherd should lead through Jesus to here, where we can be fed. Because when we leave these doors, when every Catholic leaves the doors of their church, they are again back in the corral, again living with the limitations. But they are now fed through the Eucharist. And they have the opportunity to actively change the corral, to where the corral can now mimic the pasture. I hope that that makes some sense to you. As you can see, I'm very passionate about it. That's why I love this. See? This parish still has some of the old. And when we appreciate these things, then we can appreciate our faith more. So I encourage you, pray, read, study, and pray for holy, good shepherds as priests. May Almighty God be with you. May He bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us stand now and offer our profession of faith and our creed. I believe in one God,
our Father Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through Him all things were made. For us men, for our salvation, He came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, who was on earth and earth together, and became a man. For our sake, He was crucified on Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. We will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Coming together as one family in faith, let us offer to God our prayers and our needs.
For Pope Francis and all the leaders of our church, as they strive to follow Christ the Good Shepherd and encourage us to do the same, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders in our country and the world, that they may follow the example of the Good Shepherd in caring for the needs of all those with whom they have been entrusted. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are celebrating their confirmation this Easter season, as they deepen their faith and commitment to the Lord, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For men and women in every faith community, that they might hear the voice of the Good Shepherd calling them into ordained and lay ministries. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the lost and wounded sheep of our own flock, that they may know the love and care of the Good Shepherd through our efforts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions spoken and unspoken, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Colleen McNaughton, for whom this Mass is being offered today, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Offering our prayers to the Father, let us ask for Mary's intercession during this month of May. Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God and the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Grant, we pray, O Lord, that we may always find delight in these paschal mysteries, so that the renewal constantly at work within us may be the cause of our unending joy. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, the universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Oh,
are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Thomas, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and Church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Communion chant on page 85. The Good Shepherd has risen, who laid down his life for his sheep, and willingly died for his flock. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
pray. Look upon your flock, kind shepherd, and be pleased to settle in eternal pastures the sheep you have redeemed by the precious blood of your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Would you mind having a seat for a second?
At this time, our ushers will take up our second collection for our building and maintenance fund. Thank you for your generosity toward that, because it's through that that we've been able to do so many things, such as have the statues restored. So, thank you for your continued generosity. Just a reminder to please take a bulletin home with you, because it'll say, and it'll be a good reminder for you concerning the parish picnic, which will be coming up on the 21st of May. And as we do, our spring picnic will be at St. Thomas, as our fall picnic is at St. Bridget, so the 21st of May. Another thing, this week, I have again been called back for jury duty. I'm getting used to this now, seems. But what we'll do is, last time, we'll have communion services for our 8 a.m. Mass. And as soon as I get excused again, last time it was only a day, but this time, as soon as I get excused, we'll go back to saying Mass. But in the meantime, Deacon Bullock will offer communion services. Just a note, Linda Ferrier was admitted to Providence, so please just keep her in your prayers at this time, please. Okay? All right. Y'all have a most blessed day today. Let us pray our prayer to St. Michael.
Holy Michael, be our angel. Defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And to you, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the divine power, thrust into hell, Satan and all the other evil spirits, wander through the world, seeking the ruin of souls.
Amen. The divine praises. Blessed be God.
Blessed be his holy name. Blessed be Jesus Christ, your God.